morning, everybody. Welcome to worship. I think that's the quietest we've been. As we're about to start for a while. It's good to hear the chapter as well this morning as we come and we share in fellowship together. We share all that God is doing in our lives in these days. As we come to worship, we're going to turn to Psalm 100. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord, he is good. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving, and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him, bless his name. For the Lord is good, his steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations. We're going to come and we're going to praise the Lord this morning as we gather together. We're going to sing a couple of songs at the beginning of our time together. And we're going to sing, O Lord my God, how great thou art, and over all the earth. During the singing of the second song, we're going to have our regular offering this morning. Later on, we're going to have a retiring collection for Alexis and Feline to help with their costs for funeral costs this week, just to help them out. But this is our regular giving this morning at the start of our collection. Just to let you know that the two are different. But before we do, shall we pray before we sing? Lord God, that we thank you this morning for the blessing of being able to gather together as your people. Lord, we thank you, Lord, for the freedom, Lord, that we have to do this. I thank you, Lord, that we can look at your word and we can lift our eyes up to you and we can praise you because you are our maker, you are our God, you are our King, you are our Savior. And Lord, this morning as we come and we worship, as we lift up our voices, Lord, I praise, Lord, that it will be a beautiful sound in your ears, Lord. As we lift our voices in praise to you, our God, in your name, Lord, I pray. Amen. Shall we stand and sing?
Yeah.
just going to pray together before I invite Noel to come up and join to head out. Lord God, we thank you for the many gifts, Lord, that you have given us. Lord, gifts material possessions, gifts of each other, Lord. Lord, as we give of the gifts, Lord, that you have given us financially, Lord, this morning into the church offering. Lord, we pray, Lord, that this money, Lord, will be used for your kingdom, Lord, that we will be wise with it as we proclaim your name in this community. And Lord, I pray for Noel as he's going to come and open up your word to us just now. Lord, I pray, Lord, that you will bless him, Lord, that you will speak through him. And Lord, that we will hear your voice this morning. I pray for Maggie and the team that are going out with the children just now. Again, Lord, we just pray, Lord, again, Lord, that you will use them mightily to teach the children truths of you, Lord, and what it means to be yours. Lord, we pray, Lord, again, Lord, that the children too will hear you this morning. Lord, I pray, Lord, for our church family, Lord, are not well, Lord, and we continue to pray for healing there, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that we're seeing progress there as well. Lord, we know, Lord, that there are some are grieving just now. Lord, we ask, Lord, that you will meet them in their grief. But, Lord, that they will also know the joy, Lord, that comes with the hope of the resurrection, Lord, this day. Lord, we ask this in your name. Amen. You know who's going to come and the children are going to.
Doesn't mean things don't affect us, but we're safe. And give us that safety in our heart, Jesus, to know we belong to you. If anyone here, Lord, doesn't know you as Savior, speaks directly to them this morning. Soften hearts, even as believers, soften our heart, because we go off in our angles and in our directions. And half the time, a lot of the time, we don't listen to you. Here this morning we ask a special blessing that we hear the Savior. We listen to our Savior. And above all, we follow him. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Turn your Bibles to the Gospel of Matthew chapter 3 and verse 13. Good to see so many, but with special welcome back, Caroline. Good to see you back. The Lord has blessed Caroline. Thanks everyone for the prayer. Tim, you're doing okay. But yesterday I was at the funeral of Philline's man and Alexis, a special blessing on that family. Don't forget about them, contact them, and pray for them. Again, I miss Jesus in there, I was there. I always miss Della, she was always sitting right in front of me. But again, we move but they'll move to a better place. It's called heaven. They've gone there. Matthew chapter 3, verse 13. It's after Jesus on his way. He went to baptism. He'd walked for 30 odd years here on earth as a carpenter, and now he's, he set aside the tools, the hammer, nails, all that kind of thing, and he'd gone out to spread the gospel. And it says, then Jesus came from Galilee to Jordan to be baptized by John. But John tried to defer, saying, I need to be baptized by you, and do you not come, and do you come to me? Jesus replied, let it be so now. It is proper for us to do this to fulfill the righteousness. Then John consented. As soon as Jesus was baptized, he went up out of the water. At that moment, heaven was open, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and lighting on him. And a voice from heaven said, this is my Son, whom I love. With him I am well pleased. And again, it's a call to anybody that is not baptized. Jesus himself granted their praise. And John didn't want to do it because he knew that Jesus was before him. John had said, I must decrease, he must increase. But Jesus, thank God, baptized. And again it says there, heaven opened. Do you ever think of that? Do you ever look up at the sky at night? Do you ever go to the night and think on the cup? Heaven opened. And a dove descended. We don't know. This is a picture of the Holy Spirit coming down. They are one. There's only one God. The Holy Spirit will come down on God. As on Jesus. And then the voice says, this is my Son, whom I love. With him I am well pleased. And here's our Savior. Starting out his ministry on earth. God the Father, the Holy Spirit, and God the Son. The three of them are there. United in the mission to send the word out to each one of us and anyone else. It's to all the world. Just turn to John 3:16. Most people know it, but sometimes it's better just to read it. John, the Gospel of John, chapter 3:16. And sometimes we know it, but we don't actually hear it. And it says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. That whosoever can be you, me, or anyone who chooses, put your name in there, that whosoever can be in you. And the second, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. No comments about it. There it is, certain. God is always certain. We display that way. And God's word is clear as crystal. But read on again, verse 17, we often stop. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Christ came to save. That's why he's called the Savior. Christ came to save. To seek and to save that which was lost. And oftentimes we lose sight of that in our lives, and so, and even as Christians we lose sight of what it's really about. It's about exactly what God came to do. That's why God the Father said he was pleased with his Son, because he'd done exactly what they decided in heaven. And I read it again, for God so loved the world, that's the center of Christ, and God is love. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. That's Christ. That's God. And that's the very end. To bring his home. But God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Now listen to the next verse. Verse 18. Whosoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. This is the verdict, verse 19. Light has come into the world, but But men love darkness instead of light because of deeds for evil. Verse 20, everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear that his deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives by the truth comes into the light so that they may see plainly that what he has done has been done through God. And again, the challenge is to home and read and meditate. This is God's word and this is truth. God came into the world to save people. He didn't come in to condemn. We condemn ourselves by unbelief, refusing to believe the gospel of Jesus Christ, refusing to believe that Jesus is the Savior and the only way to heaven. No other way. And we talk about all types of things, but that is the way. But to contradict Galatians chapter 5. I think there's a new edition of it. Yes. Galatians chapter 5, verse 18. See, the world system, and if you get a chance again, we read a little bit, we're studying it as a tune tonight, 1 John, the little epistle of John, the letter of John towards the back. Love is. And the contrast of the world system to God's way. The topic of they run parallel, but never meet. They come from a different source, and they end up in a different place. So again, the world system is controlled by the devil, even though we don't like to even know he exists. But that's the system there. Now, as an unbeliever, this is what God says about us. Galatians chapter 5, verse 18. Now we started 16. So I say, live by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the sinful nature. For the sinful nature desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the sinful nature. See the opposites? Sinful nature and the nature controlled by the Spirit are contrary, they're opposites. They are in conflict with each other. So that you do not know what you want. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. And then he lists some of the sinful nature. And think of this. Think of these things. Are they in your life? If you're an unbeliever, you definitely are. And hear what he says. Verse 19. The acts of sinful nature are obvious. Sexual immorality, impurity, debauchery, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissensions, factions, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and the like. I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. Certainly, that's the way you live. Look at the world. That's the way it is. Selfish ambition. Get to the top. Look out for yourself. Let me give a few bits here and there to have God mercy. Walk by the Good Samaritan. Think of the Good Samaritan. And many of us are like that priest and Levi. We see the need, we just have time to come up on this, but we're doing something else. We're doing something more than anything for ourselves. We walk by and look at the chaos of our world. People, we've seen pictures of Afghanistan and we know what's going on over there. But it's going on here, right beside us. We let on stop, that's no remark. You don't change, light and dark opposite. Walking in the Spirit and walking by the desires of the sinful nature are opposites. They never meet. Now here's some of the things that God through his Savior Jesus Christ, as he comes into your heart through the Holy Spirit, these are things he calls us to be. But the fruit of the Spirit, verse 22, chapter 5 of Galatians. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law. Those who belong to Jesus Christ have crucified the sinful nature with its passions and desires. Since we live by the Spirit, let us keep step with the Spirit. Let us not become conceited, provoking, and envying each other. And there they are, the characteristics of a Christian. Love. Love is the whole thing. God's God. That love is only the love of Jesus. Love and all. God says, love your neighbor. And he says, love your neighbor. Who is my neighbor? Remember, the fellow asked Jesus, who is my neighbor? Good Samaritan. Kindness. I always come to kindness because my dad always talked about kindness. It costs you nothing to be kind. He said, we grew up as children. He used to say a lot. And he was a very kind man himself. But kindness doesn't cost you anything. What's the opposite of kindness?
Selfishness.
Couldn't get a better word on that. Selfishness, self-centered. See the Levite walking by Caroline and God injured and just walking on. Do I walk by people in need and know people in need and not bother? Jesus, that great Savior, looked down on heaven from heaven, God the Father and the Holy Spirit. And saw me and saw you and said, we ain't going to make it home. I'm going to hell. That's where he came down. The Savior, he came down. He didn't stand up there and say, oh. Gave his life. That's love. Loving people. And a lot of people say, no, you don't know anybody in need. I said, you're not looking too hard here. We're so self-centered, we actually don't see people. So to help yourself, you don't actually see me. And people often think need is about money, no, it's about you. About me sharing my life with somebody. Or getting into someone else's life and helping them, encourage them and lifting them up. Pouring yourself into them. Money might be made. But it's you, and me, and Jesus that makes the difference. One of the verses I just read, Brother Love, as a young Christian, I was shown this, it's in Galatians as well, chapter 2, verse 20. I've often thought about it. And it says, I've been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I live in the body, I live by the faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. Think of that. He loved you. Gave himself for me. He knows the cross. He looked on the sinner, saw there was only one way to get him home. He gave himself. We need to meditate on this. We need to meditate on Christ and see him walk on this earth, reaching this friend that way everywhere. God will feed his eyes. I'm reaching down from there, right down through the centuries to us. Looking for you. People say you found Christ. No, I didn't find Christ. Christ found me. Christ, we don't find Christ. Christ finds us. He comes into our life and he saves. John, the Gospel of John, chapter 13. Verse 24. Love, exactly. Do you love people? So many people in our life, and maybe in myself, have the example, carry grudges, don't forgive, won't forgive, won't forgive. Carry grudges, carry them with you. Someone done something like that, you talk to them, and you carry that with you, and you refuse. Nothing got to do with Christ. Jesus died for me, but I was a sinner, was anyway. See, Christ's love crosses all barriers. He pours the Spirit in us and he wants us to cross all barriers. If the person rejects it, it doesn't matter. Reach out. Here's what he says. Turning 34. A new command I give you. Love one another as I have loved you. So you must love one another. By this all men will know that you are my disciples if you love one another. We have to be different. We're not the same as everybody else. Light and dark are not the same, they're opposites. The sinful nature is contrary to the walk of the Spirit. God says, that's how people will know us, by our love for one another. And then we will reach out love toward me. John 14, I'm always caught up with John. John is an incredible word. You read the Gospel of John. John 14, read a few verses from 15. And here's Jesus speaking to me, you, and anyone that will listen. Here's what he says. If you love me, you will obey what I command. We don't like that word obey, do we? The children grew up as animals, the children of God, we don't like that word either. If you love me, you will obey what I command, and I'll ask the Father, and he'll give you another counselor to be with you forever, the Spirit of Truth. The world cannot accept him because it neither sees him nor knows him. But you know him, for he lives in you and will be in you. I will not leave you as orphans, I will come to you. Before long the world will not see me anymore. But you will see me, because I live, you will also live. Verse 20. On that day you realize that I am in the Father, and you are in me, and I am in you. Me are one, Jesus said, and you are in me, and you are one. Saying one church, God's church, not our church, God's church, but part of the body. On that day, look at verse 20, you realize that I am in my Father, and you are in me, and I am in you. Whosoever has my commands and obeys them, he is the one who loves me. He who loves me will be loved by the Father. And I too will love him and show myself to him. That's right. And we love him. Jesus talking straight to you. Look at him. The problem we have is we don't read. We don't bother. I'll wait 5 minutes here to read and sit with your Savior. He says later on in verse 27 of that chapter, peace I leave with you, my peace I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid. Remember, he said it to his disciples so often, don't be afraid of me. After the crucifixion, when they were floating out of the room, probably about this day, they're all gathered together, the door was locked, and Jesus appeared. Didn't open the door, just appeared. Jesus is saying to us today, don't be afraid. I'm God Almighty. I'm sovereign. Nothing surprises me. And I am with you. Peace in it. And constantly the world bombards us with the opposite. Fear this, fear that, fear everything. The COVID was a great example. Fear it. You don't have to fear it. God knows all about COVID and all about every other disease. And people keep saying, but you're going to die anyway, the chance of you dying of COVID are remote, but you're going to die where you go. But COVID brought death to open doors to talk to people. Where are you going? Where are you going to spend eternity? The pastor preached yesterday at the gravesite, and he was talking about come home and have you ready. Are you ready? Go to the door. You might need to get up off. You might need to walk off this stage. We're gone, God. Where are we going? I'm going to heaven. Jesus said it's good enough for me. Born again, repentance. All these things. But we have to think and meditate. Think about it. And then look at some says, or look at your family, or some of your friends, not saved, we know they're not saved. Do you pray for your friends? Do you pray for your family? Do you pray for your brothers and sisters here that God would encourage their hearts and give them the power to share the gospel and the light to shine in people? What did he say? By this all men will know that you are my disciples if you love one another. That's the characteristic of a Christian. Love it to one another. Think of Jesus. Think of when think of the stories you heard about Christ and walking along, talking to people, lepers, didn't matter who they were. Zacchaeus. Come down and go to your house. Jesus wants to come into your heart. Jesus wants to communicate with you. Jesus wants you to talk to him and tell him, I don't understand this. Close the thing, I don't understand. But he's my father. And he says, no, often, come over here for a minute. He speaks often to James, which speaks often to the Bible. So if someone says something to me, it clicks. We need to get together more, talk about Christ, not about the weather and COVID. It's okay. But talk about God. What's he doing in your life? What does it mean to you to be a Christian? What does it mean to you to be a follower of Christ? And what does it mean? What mission has God for you to serve him in the world? Because he died for the world. He said, God loved the world. Everybody. Put you in places that I'm not going to be. But where I am, I have to represent Christ. Sometimes we can't be brave enough to talk about it, but sometimes just let him before you see him. Ask God to give you the courage to share it. In love, not ramming down someone's neck or contradicting what they're doing. Sharing the gospel, love. You have to go to 1 John. 1 John chapter 4. Lord of man. And all over this little epistle of 1 John, I tell anybody, I'm always asking you, read 1 John. Same writer that wrote the Gospel, the same writer that wrote Revelation, and people are all talking about Revelation. I said, no, I pray you don't read it. I said, I read 1 John. Because a lot of Revelation I still don't understand. I might never understand. I know it's like truth because God wrote it. True John. But 1 John, you will understand it. And it's clear as crystal, and not a lot of most of it. But this is what he says. I read a few passages. 1 John chapter 4, verse 7. Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. This is how God shows love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love. Not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sin. Dear friends, if God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God. But if we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is made complete in us. Don't have to explain that, do I? God just tells us who we are, what he is, and how we should live. And it's clear. Read it again, it's clear. God is love. God is love. Everything about God is love. There it is written, telling us how to live a life. Just move back to chapter 3, verse 11. And this is an interesting passage. This is the message you've heard from the beginning. We should love one another. And over and over and over again, God said we should love one another. Now, I want to study the other night. How do we demonstrate it? How do you know someone loves you? How do you know? honesty from the person. This is a message you've heard from the beginning. We should love one another. And then he gives an example. Do not be like Cain, who belonged to the evil one and murdered his brother. And why did he murder him? Because his own actions were evil and his brothers were righteous. He hated him. The opposite of love is hate. The opposite of love is to love the thing blocked in love. Nothing blocks grace from love. Do not be surprised, my brothers, if the world hates you. We know that we have passed from death to life because we love our brothers. Anyone who does not love remains in death. Verse 15. Anyone who hates his brother is a murderer. And you know that no murderer has eternal life. Verse 18. This is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers. If anyone has material possessions and sees his brother in need, but has no pity on him, how can the love of God be in him? And that's what we're discussing on that. How can the love of God be in you? You say you love God. How can it be in you if you see a brother in need and you know there's a need? And what does he say? But it's no pity. How can it be? The answer is not in you. It's in your head, but it's not in you. You imagine you love God, and you imagine, but you don't. But God says, if you love me, you love your neighbor. If you love me, you love your brother. You won't walk by me, you won't ignore people. You may see a person in need, and you can help. You will help. That's what Christ done. And that's what he's done as he's here on earth. Being shows the example of his great love for us. That's what he's done. See, he says over and over, not hearers of the word, but be doers of the word. And then he said, if you're a hearer of the word and not a doer, you're just deceiving yourself. It's all in your head. You hear it, you quote the verses, but you're not living it. He wants us to live the life. Connect with each other, connect with people. And reach out to the lost people. I said, you can't save anyone, but you can give them the message and the power of the Holy Spirit that can. And that's what God wants us to be, the messenger, the sower, you know, the sower, the seed. The seed is the word of God. We need to spread it out there, tell people about it. But we don't want to run into harm. We're not the church, it doesn't matter. We're to go and tell people. Again, the challenge is, who do you talk to in Christ? I have a sister. I was talking to her last night. A number of years ago, Linda came to church, professed to be saved, and came to church for 2 or 3 years, and then stopped. And again, she had an operation there, she had a hip replacement. But I was talking to her last night, and her husband, Paul. And I remember Corey had an accident years ago. He fell out of a pattern. And they thought he had some serious brain damage. Yeah, I was like, he had anyway. But he has to pray for him. He's praying. But he was all right. He got the x-rays, they were all clear. And he came to Bible Surgery a few times. As soon as he got all right, he was gone. Need to live the life before them to see it. It's not just talk. They know. People know. We read people all the time. Oftentimes mystery. But in general we know what people are like. We know that people that we're in need we can go to. And we know other people who don't say a word, but to tell everybody. And definitely won't help us anyway. But God, Christ, tells us, verse 86, this is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for our brother. Don't count the cost, do it. Don used to say, Pastor, years ago, God is a bigger shovel, you can't outgive God. You're a generous person. You're a giver. And I'll come to the name. Because God loves givers. For God so loved the world, He gave His only Son. God loves givers. And firstly, a lot of times we are holders. We hold on. Does it in God used to say, don't be a grasper, don't be hanging on with the open hand. Giving is open hand, giving. The grasper and the horror holds on. You might say, what can I give? Squeeze out a bit of you. I should offer an hour, half an hour here physically, but I'm on the stage. Don't be miserable in your giving of yourself. Not money, not having money. Because that will fall. If you're a giver of your life, and you're a giver of yourself, as God puts into us that He is, you have no problem giving money or tax on or whatever it is. The value of his material possessions and sees his brother in need, but has no pity on how can the love of God be in him? It can't. Dear children, let us not love with words of the tongue, but with actions and with truth. This then is how we know that we belong to the truth and how we set our hearts at rest in His presence. God is love. God is love. He demonstrated it at Calvary's cross, and He demonstrated His power of resurrection. Turn to Philippians chapter 3. Here's another book. I tell people, keep reading this book. It's clear as crystal. It's there. It's not hard to understand. And it shows you about your life. How to live. Philippians chapter 3. And if you could read anywhere in Philippians. It says in chapter 1, I just read verse 21, for me to live is Christ, to die is gain. Is that how you feel? To live, you're living your life for Christ, but to die in atonement. That's what Paul. Do you remember Paul? Paul is savage of a man, crushing the church of God, getting people killed, and Stephen, the saint of God, he was there when the mob stoned him to death. And he was the leader. And he was the man who was anti-Christ, against God, against Christ. God told him. Galatians chapter 3, verse 7. But whatever was to my profit, I now consider loss for the sake of Christ. What is more, I consider everything a loss compared to the surpassing greatness of knowing Christ Jesus my Savior, for whose sake I've lost all things. Listen to that again. Think of the holding that we do, the holding on, the won't give, the won't go, the won't see me, listen to what Paul said. What is more, I consider everything a loss compared to the surpassing greatness of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whose sake I've lost all things. I consider them rubbish, that I may gain Christ and be found in Him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which is true faith in Christ, the righteousness that comes from God and is by faith. Verse 10, I want to know Christ and the power of His resurrection, the fellowship of sharing in His suffering, becoming like Him in His death, and so somehow to obtain the resurrection. Changed man. A changed man. A man who was against God, against His church, against the people, killing him. And here God put him as one of the great leaders of the church. Is that how you feel? I read it again. What is more, I consider everything a loss compared to the surpassing greatness of knowing Jesus Christ, my Savior, for whose sake I've lost all things. Paul is a prisoner now. Paul was on the ladder of success. He was going to be one of the great leaders in the Jewish religion. And here he is a prisoner. But he considered it all of rubbish compared to knowing Christ? Is that how you feel about Christ? Christ is Christ first in your life.
That's the key.
I mean, sometimes, you have to say, Christ, I've forgotten what you've done. I've forgotten who you are. You know, my children, it's hard to forget you now and find you a nuisance. Oh, the little children, when his father died, it's grown up and worse. But we're like that. We get to know the Lord and be kind to us. Suddenly we lose that zeal for God. The excitement of Christ. The excitement of the world. I don't even bother reading it. I know we don't talk to people. I know sometimes, thank God at the moment I'm feeling that I love reading more. Sometimes you really have to push yourself to do it. As soon as you get reading and back, sometimes something more important. There's always something. We've got so busy with things that time crisis brings out. Are you excited coming to church? Are you excited gathering with your fellow believers? Are you excited by hearing God's word? He says that the presence of God here amongst us. Christ is here. That's just amazing. Christ is here. Now, looking at you, listening to us, knows I haven't a clue what you're thinking. God here. In our presence. God Almighty. And think of what he's done. I always think of the devil. Unfortunately, most of us have to die. There's a time when some people have to die. It's a doorway to heaven. And it's not comfortable because it's not where we were born to die originally. Sin causes death. The wages of sin is death. The gift of God is eternal life. We don't talk about it. Eternal life. So what? Does it not make sense? If God has given you eternal life, he's gone to prepare a place for you and he'll bring you there. What could be better? Why are we telling people about it? Because they don't seem to say anything about it. Couldn't care less about it. Yes. It's hard to comprehend if you don't do the same for God. To know Christ. To know Christ. John 4. Of Philippians chapter 4, verse 4. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Are you rejoicing in God your Savior? Am I rejoicing in God your Savior? Let your gentleness be evident to all that the Lord is near. The Lord is here. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and petition, let your thanksgiving present your request to God. And here we go. The peace of God. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, will guard your hearts and your mind in Christ Jesus. Remember Sean talking in Philippians, or Ephesians, preaching. In Christ Jesus. It's in Christ Jesus. It's not outside. The peace is in him, with him, him in us, through the Holy Spirit. I read it again. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again. Rejoice, let your gentleness be evident to all. And the gentleness, the fruit of the Spirit, one of them is gentleness. Bernie always on me, probably with that word. She reminds me. She said, you're too harsh. You're too harsh. I said, what? But she's right. She's not really, she can't go wrong. Sometimes when you get harsh and Christians, you know, jump in and hurt somebody. The tongue. You can hurt people very quickly with the tongue. Very easily. You might mean it. That's my excuse, anyway. You might deliberately go to hurt people, but you hurt people. I'm just saying. Read James. Guard your tongue. Read the epistle of James about the tongue. smooth and firm vital wind. The words have cut the bits. Do not be anxious, verse 6, about anything, but in everything by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your request to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. It's always in Christ Jesus. What time is it, James? Read the Old Testament, read through the people that love Christ, what they've done, what was done to them at times. I was reminded, I was up in Scary there on the preacher, and a chap said, you preach a Mishnite, Shadrach, and Abednego. Does anybody know them, please? Mishnite, Shadrach, and Abednego. I just thrown back, it's in Daniel, but it is a new one. But Daniel was one of these great men of God. But a few little fellas around him weren't far behind him. And these three fellas, taken into slavery with Daniel. And here's what they done. A fellow called Nebuchadnezzar, chapter 3 of Daniel, says, King Nebuchadnezzar made an image of gold 90 feet high and 9 feet wide. It was pretty tall. Gold. Statue. What week did that say? 20 feet. But 4.5 times as high as a pillar. And he made this statue, and the idea was you bow down and worship. You had to bow down to this statue. And these three fellas, this is what it said. Shadrach, verse 16. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego replied to King O Nebuchadnezzar, we do not need to defend ourselves before you in this battle. If we're thrown into the blazing furnace, the God we serve is able to save us from it, and he will rescue us from your hand, O King. But even if he doesn't, we want you to know, O King, that we will never serve your God or worship the image of God. And here, Mishnah, Shadrach, and Abednego refused to bow to the statue the king put up, and death was in front. Brought before the furnace, King was there and he said, you don't bow down, I'm going to throw you into the furnace. And Mishnah, Shadrach, and Abednego, talking about their trust in the Savior, they said, we're not going to bow down. And if you do trust in this fire, we know, we believe that God can save us through it. But if he doesn't, there's a possibility that God will do what he wants to do. If he doesn't, we're still not going to bow down. What happened to Daniel? The true men. Read Daniel, read the true men. And Nebuchadnezzar is looking, and he's looking into the front, it wasn't big in front. But he saw four people in there. Read the story of the power of God, how he stands by his people, puts us to the test of the age. We're literally thrown into the front. Don't walk around. We need to hear the Old Testament. We need to hear the resolve of Christ, the certainty of his help, the protection of God, the power of God. And Daniel, remember Daniel, when the lion was dead. Gideon would not. He went and prayed, and he said, assuming the lion's dead. What happened in there? This is your God. Have you circumstances in your life that are very difficult? You might be afraid to even talk to anyone about it. Talk to God. Talk to your Savior. He might in the direction and might be someone they want who can help you. But talk to God about your life. It might be a major thing at all. It might be just sin. You know, when sin seems to creep around on us, we begin to have it, we give it up. Thank God, it makes it even us, we're doing it again. So easily creep up on us. Daniel, Mishnah, Shadrach, and Abednego. But God is love. Turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 13. John is not with us. John reads this quite again. Verse 13, or chapter 13. And you have to, as we sit down or stand, whatever we're doing, get along with God with the Word. Get the Word. Bible there, paper. If you haven't got one, get a Bible in your hand. And all these things are great things. Get a Bible in your hand, because it's the Word of God and nothing else is in there. Only the Word of God. These other things are all the better. And we can be so distracted. And a few things are doing in there, I don't know much about them anyway. But I do know it's a lot. You read it, some man pops up in the middle of it. From nowhere. Something's happened. Something's not that happened. But the Word of God, that's why I keep telling them, get the Word of God, they're there, take them, give them out when you can. Because it's the Word of God, and that's all you need. John 13, again, we're talking about the love of God for us and how we can spread the love of our neighbour as ourselves. And reach out to our individual lives. But live in it. This is what 1 Corinthians chapter 13, read a few verses. If I speak, Paul writing, if I speak in the tongues of men and of angels, but have not love, I'm only a resembling God or a clanging cymbal. And if I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have faith that can move mountains, but I have not love, I am nothing. If I give all my possessions to the poor and surrender my body to the flames, but have not love, I gain nothing. And here we are, verse 4. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It is not rude. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Verse 8. Love never fails. We skip on to verse 13. And now these three remain: faith, hope, and love. The greatest of these is love. Heavenly Father, you've written in your word. Help us to read it. And then help us to write it in our hearts, in our life. Love is patient, love is kind, it does not envy, it does not boast, it's not proud, it's not rude, not self-seeking, not easily angered, keep no record of wrongs, love does not delight in evil, but rejoices in the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hope, always perseveres, but never fails, because you are love. We know you are love, and as your children, being in your Lord, we're to love. Again, this seems important for us at times. That's when we need to reflect on how you live your life. You walk this earth, know what's going to happen to you. You've done good for everybody, reached out in all directions. And at the end, the crowd shall be crucified. But love didn't leave, stop loving. He still loved them. An amazing thing for us to learn. As you hung on the cross, you said, Father, forgive them. If we only could love, but we can. But oftentimes the world we should do is we won't. We won't forgive. We carry grudges. We do keep record of wrongs. That's the one that always gets you, because that's so easily have at the end of the back of your mind to draw it over when you get the opportunity. Father, come into our life, blow out all this rubbish, as Paul talks about, and help us understand who we are in you. And it's in you. our children, God. We represent you, your body on this earth. You are truth, and you are the light. That's what we are supposed to be. Help us to be it. We have the power because the Holy Spirit's in us. It's just this old nature of error. I don't know how it works. But it's so easy, it sneaks up on us, and we're running with the rabbit. We're doing everything, and everything seems okay. Help us, Lord, to represent you as you want us, as you have empowered us. And again, make the fruit of the Spirit, here it is in Corinthians. Love never fails. Love never fails. Because you are. Thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
Going to sing together, just one song, Here Is Love Vast As the Ocean, and then we'll have the announcements, so shall we stand?
Thank you.
This morning we're going to, in just a few moments, we're going to take up a retiring collection for Alexis and Friedlein. This is to help with their funeral costs for Friedlein's mother. It's a very expensive business, and they just need a little bit of help to help cover some of their costs. So this week and next week, so if you've not come prepared this week, don't worry about it. We'll have one next week as well, just give people a chance to contribute as God lays on your heart. So we're going to do that in a few moments. Another way in which we can help, if someone is available tomorrow morning for a lift to go to the hospital, need to be there by 10 o'clock, so around 9 o'clock to be leaving here. If someone is available, please then see me after the service, and we can arrange that. And just to remind you that the ministry sheets will go back at the back of the hall again this week. This will be the third, should have been the third week that we were doing this. I forgot to put them out last week, haven't announced it. if they're not there, come and see me and remind me that they're not there, and I can make sure that they're about there. Again, you're not saying that I'm going to be forever and a day doing that particular job, but that you're interested and you want us to speak to. If you've already put your name down, we only have your details when we contact you in the next week, just to start that conversation with you. If you haven't and would like to, children's ministry, youth ministry, set up a technical team looking after all the equipment, then you can put your names on there. There's four different sheets for that. We also have on Tuesday our Bible study at 8 o'clock at John and Maggie's and mine and Nancy's house. This coming Wednesday we have our youth Bible study at 4 o'clock, and then next Sunday we have our worship service at 10:30 here. So we're just going to wait upon you for the retiring collection. We're just going to play some music, and if Sean can help us with that. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers of this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, having done all to stand firm. Stand therefore, having fastened on the belt of truth, having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and as shoes for your feet, having put on the readiness given by the gospel of peace. In all circumstances, take up the shield of faith, with which you can extinguish all the flaming darts of the evil one, and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, praying at all times in the Spirit, with all prayer and supplication. To that end, keep alert with all perseverance, making supplication for all the saints.